Recently, I realized that I don't have a video comparing vitamin K1 to vitamin K2. So I wanted to create this video to talk about each one. Vitamin K1 has everything to do with blood clotting and bone metabolism. If you're deficient in vitamin K1, you may have bruising, or if you cut yourself and you're bleeding and it's taking a very long time to clot or heal up, you can be deficient in vitamin K1. Also, if you have bleeding gums, if you're brushing your teeth, now that could be also vitamin C, but it could also be a deficiency of vitamin K1. So vitamin K1 is very, very important to your survival, because if you didn't have it and you got injured, you could literally bleed to death internally or externally. So based on that, our bodies have made sure that we rarely ever run out of vitamin K1. And on top of that, there's so many different foods that we eat that have vitamin K1. It's very unlikely you're going to be deficient, especially since the requirement for K1 are not even milligrams, they're in micrograms. So we need very small amounts to satisfy the requirements. Now, where do you get vitamin K1? Primarily from plant sources. Now, vitamin K1 is also in animal foods as well, but not in the amounts that you would get from plants, like leafy greens. Now, just to switch over to vitamin K2, this nutrient has everything to do with calcium control. It prevents calcium from accumulating in your vascular system. And it also has everything to do with bone strength. So it keeps the calcium in the bone, and it keeps the calcium out of the soft tissues. And vitamin K2 is primarily in animal products like animal fat, and it's also in fermented food like natto, which is a fermented soybean. It's also in sauerkraut, but it's very, very high in beef liver, for example, or pork liver, or pork proteins, or chicken, or beef, egg yolks, soft cheeses. So right there, you can see that our bodies were meant to consume both plant and animal foods based on nutrients that our body needs. Now realize that vitamin K is fat soluble. So the vitamin K1 in plants is very poorly absorbed. In fact, you only absorb less than 10% of it. Good thing you don't need very much, but it's very poorly absorbed. But as a survival mechanism, what we've done to counteract that is we just recycle the vitamin K1. So if you're not consuming much K1, our body's going to take what we have and keep recycling it over and over and over. Now, vitamin K2 is much better absorbed. Why? Because it comes with fat. And anytime you consume a fat-soluble vitamin with fat, you're going to absorb it more. It's also going to stimulate bile, which is going to help you absorb that fat-soluble vitamin. So it's a combination of bile and then the pancreatic enzyme called lipase that helps you break down the food and absorb these nutrients more effectively. Now, what most people do, including myself, when you're doing a salad, for example, you're going to be using oil, like olive oil, to help the absorption. You're going to help the absorption of vitamin K1. Now, one thing you need to know about vitamin K2 is that the bacteria in your colon can actually make K1 from vitamin K2. So this is another survival mechanism that if you have the microbes in your gut, you'll be able to make more K2 from K1. If you're on a low-fat diet, that's going to be a problem to get this. If you have inflammation in your gut anywhere, as diverticulitis or colitis or Crohn's, any digestive issue, you're going to have malabsorption. You're not going to be able to absorb this one or this one as well. If you had your gallbladder removed, that could also create a deficiency because you're not going to make enough bile, in which case you just need to take purified bile salts. If you have a fatty liver or your liver is damaged, you're not going to be able to make bile to be able to use that to absorb these two fat-soluble vitamins as well. If you're on a blood thinner like warfarin, that's going to block K1, and you will have deficiencies of that. And as a side note, if you are on warfarin, I have a video explaining the types of vegetables you should be consuming, which are low in vitamin K1, if you're interested in doing the diet that I always recommend, which is healthy keto. Basically, you just eliminate the leafy greens and you do other types of vegetables. I put that video right down below. All right, guys, so now you know the difference between vitamin K1 and K2. Before you go, if you have a question about a product, or you're new to keto and you want to know how to begin keto, or you're on keto and you need a debug because it's not going as smooth, I have a keto consultant standing by to help you. This is just for the people in the US. Hopefully in the future we'll be able to answer everyone's call. But I put the number down below so you can call and get some help.